Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our webinar on IRC guidelines on urban road network planning. ITDP India Programme has been part of the HED Committee on Urban Roads and Streets that was constituted in 2015 to prepare street design guidelines for urban roads. The webinar will cover planning and development of urban roads and streets by Sonal Shah, our Senior Programme Manager at ITDP. IRC BRT guidelines by Pranjali, Deshpande, who is our Programme Manager at ITDP. And IRC 70 guidelines for regulations and control of mixed traffic by Parin, who is our Research Associate at ITDP. And without further ado, over to you, Sonal.
Yeah. Thank you, Kashmira, for organizing this. A brief background. The H8 committee is part of the Indian Roads Congress, focusing specifically on guidelines for urban roads and streets. Shreya is part of the committee on behalf of ITDP. Now, IRC also has other committees, for example, on rural roads and so forth. And so, like I said, the H8 committee focuses specifically on urban roads and streets. The first committee's tenure was from about 2015 to 17. And the next committee, of which again we are part of, is from 2018 to 2020. Now, in the last committee, we played a very proactive role and were instrumental in either contributing towards a number of documents. So we played an instrumental role in this new document on planning and development of urban roads and streets. This one does not exist within the current IRC guidelines, which focused on what should be the guidelines for road network planning in new areas as well as existing areas. And this was seen as a mother document that would set the tone for all other documents henceforth. So we were responsible for, in a way, first supporting and then pretty much writing the whole document on planning and development of urban roads and streets, revising IRC 70, which is a regulation for mixed traffic in urban areas, and introduced a new document called the IRC BRT guidelines. Now, typically, how does the IRC H8 committee work? They for each document, you have different subcommittees, and the subcommittee has a chair. And the subcommittees deliberate or discuss the documents away from the main committee and then present in monthly meetings of the main committee. Okay. Now, once a document is approved by the H8 committee, it goes to the Highway Standards and Specifications Committee. And once it is approved by them, it is then presented to the IRC Council, which meets about twice a year. And so this is the process typically followed. Now, as far as all these three documents that we are going to discuss today are concerned, is they've been approved by the IRC Council, but there have been edits and changes, and we were expecting them to be published in the IRC Council by May end. So we should, fingers crossed, have the printed copies of these documents very soon. Okay. So what are the chapters? Now, I am presenting a version of the document which was presented in October 2017 in the final meeting of the IRC Council. Chapter 3, Transport Network Planning, I believe, has been removed. I'm still going to retain it. What we are planning as a group is to see that how we can maybe reinstate this in the main document as well. So I will focus, I'll move through this a little fast because we are all aware of these. So the first chapter looks at the challenges of urban roads that look at, for example, the relationship between low density single land use planning and increased motorization, which again leads to an increase in the growth of vehicular traffic. This presents perhaps a slightly dated study conducted by Wilbur Smith Associates on behalf of the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs that looked at 30 cities across, modal splits of 30 cities across India, and found that anywhere close to about more than half the number of trips in our cities were by walk, cycle, and public transport. However, our streets are designed for cars, and the goal of this document was to ensure a balanced distribution of road space with a priority for pedestrians, cyclists, public transport, and so forth. And one of the things that was emphasized is that we needed to look at the complete trip chain, which was looking at the complete access from origin to destination. So what were the principles underpinning urban roads and streets focused on accessibility, safety and comfort, ecology, and social concerns? And so what was the road classification that this document recommended? Arterial roads, subarterial roads, collector streets, local streets. And then we had special cases, which included urban expressways, as well as NMT streets. So we recommended that a city should have an arterial road network of 1 by 1 kilometers. And we were constantly thinking that we would have to have two separate guidelines for new roads, new areas, and existing areas. If you will see that the right of way in new areas is much higher than what you will observe in existing areas, right? But we wanted to bring this distinction because we know that in a city like Ranchi, you have a 24 meter right of way, which also functions as an arterial road. So this was agreed by the committee. And so in new areas, the arterial roads will be from 45 to 60 meters right of way, with design speeds in planes at 60 kilometers per hour. We also, however, focused on posted speeds, which said that the speed limit would be 20 kilometers per hour within 100 meters of land uses with significant pedestrian cross movement. Now, one of the things that we have really been pushing for is there is really no difference, if you will, in the classification of arterial and subarterial roads, right? We were trying to see how we could have had only three categories, arterial, collector, and local, but then this came back and was inserted in. For subarterial roads, the network should be 500 by 500 meters and a 30 to 45 meters right of way in new areas. The design speeds is recommended at 60 kilometers per hour in plains. Posted speeds, again, 20 kmph within 100 meters of land uses with significant pedestrian movements. Now, this document also has street design sections and plans. We had inserted these in the main document, but I'll be honest, I'm not sure how many of these we have right now. Now for collector streets, we recommended a network of 250 by 250 meters network, and in new areas, the right of way would be 15 to 30 meters with design speeds of 40 kilometers per hour in plain areas. And the posted speeds runs across all the three, arterial, subarterial, and collector streets. Now, what we recommended here were two things, is that, now, what were the recommendations for pedestrian infrastructure? In each of these, we emphasized IRC 103, Guidelines for Pedestrian Facilities. For cycle tracks, especially for collector roads, we said that we could have side cycle tracks for roads of 24 to 30 meters wide, but between 20 to 24, we could consider cycle tracks on one side of the road as well. And for roads below 20 meters, we would then have a shared space for cyclists. But in all of this, we have mentioned that the footpaths need to be designed as per IRC 103. For local streets, we recommended a network of 125 by 125 meters. In new areas, the right of way could vary from 10 to 15 meters with design speeds in planes at 30 kilometers per hour. And the posted speeds remain the same. Now, in the case of special streets like NMT streets, we recommended 7.5 meters right of way that could, for example, combine a footpath and a cycle track, but you could also have only a pedestrian path, and that could be 4 meters if you're only thinking of a pedestrian path. In special cases, we had urban expressways. What is the goal of an urban expressway, which caters to long distance regional passenger and goods traffic? The right of way, I think this is perhaps wrong. The right of way can be more. I'm just going to check on that. The vehicle movement, the goal of an urban expressway would be to ensure that access was controlled. In the sense that this would prioritize through vehicular movement with access to properties through service roads. And any bypass would be decided by city, municipal, and development authorities in consultation with the road agencies. And we said that interchanges may be provided. Here, the design speeds were recommended at 80 kilometers per hour. And in the case of urban expressways, we recommended grade separated access for pedestrians. There was a lot of discussion and pushing for separate cycle tracks on urban expressways, but I'm not sure if this is part of the main document right now. What we also recommended was principles for how to plan a road network. And the case was for providing a denser street grid, the advantages of which were that this would therefore allow us to reduce the right of way, but provide a denser street network. It obviously provides more travel choices for walking and cycling, similarly for emergency services. And speeds are likely to go down, also resulting in lower road fatalities. And then the other argument was saying that connectivity would also improve the economy because it would improve access to amenities, homes, offices, retail, and so forth. I should again reiterate that this chapter, I believe, is not in the planning manual right now, but I think it's just worthwhile sharing it anyways. The manual actually defined road network in multiple ways. One was by block length, and we recommended that the block length would not be more than 150 meters. And a block length is the length of a urban block which is bound by public streets. So you would not, for example, consider gated communities within this because the entire gated community in that sense would serve as the block length, the length of the gated community. There were also other ways, we have a block length over here. There were other ways in which you could also determine a block area standard, and there is plan A and plan B, which demonstrate two alternatives of designing the same block. The emphasis is that, like we said, that the length should not exceed 150 meters in each case. The another way to also decide the block sizes is giving intersection densities, right? So there are multiple ways. Like we said, you can give, so the diagram below talks about how many intersections you can have in one square kilometer, and which would result in corresponding block sizes and perimeters. So there are multiple ways in which we can give guidelines on block sizes. While perimeter might be one, it is always useful to emphasize the maximum block length. This was just some example. So another way, so we said block length, block area, perimeter, and we can also look at another tool, which was known as the pedestrian route directness, which actually measures the actual distance from say point A to point B versus the shortest distance. And we recommended that the ratio of the actual to the shortest should not be more than 1.5. We also made recommendations on access management, particularly looking at service roads. One, again, our concern over here was to limit, for example, the width of the service lane to, I mean, it was finally, I think, accepted at about 3 meters and then have a multifunctional zone, which could be designed in multiple ways. So there are, we've given 3 conditions. One is where there are high boundary walls so that you can actually have the parking along the boundary wall. The other is where the boundary wall is less than 1.2 meters and you could have a footpath along with the footpath, including the multifunctional zone. And the last one. And the last is a commercial area where we could actually, where there is no boundary wall and the footpath and the private property can also adjoin each other. Our goal over here was to discourage the through move, or was to discourage the use of service roads for through movement. So this is something that we were trying very hard to again push for. The earlier recommendation said that the width of the service lane should be, a service road should be 5.5 meters. So the final recommendation actually says 3 to 5.5 meters while recommending a lower a width for a service road precisely to avoid one, two-way and through movement. So the planning manual also recommends a street design and implementation process. So we recommended an institutional framework as well as a planning and implementation framework. So in the, we recommended that a street design cell be constituted within road departments of urban local bodies, parastatal agencies, and for example, and the public works department. And the goal of the street design cell would be to create a comprehensive street design network plan of the for the city, review and monitor the street design and implementation process, arrange capacity development and training for technical and other personnel. And the role of the street design cell would be also to facilitate community engagement and advocacy for complete streets. And who could the street design cell include? Urban and transport planners, urban designers, landscape architects, traffic and civil engineers, GIS specialists, and external consultants advising on road safety, universal access, and women's safety. This is again a broad framework. Of course, each city could actually then create its own street design cell within the framework of this. We also recommended a review committee whose goals would be to oversee the street design proposals that were created by the consultants and might also work perhaps as a way to address any interagency coordination that can arise in the process. So who could be the members of the review committee? Officials from the municipal corporation, representatives from public transport agencies, traffic police, local planning or development authority, NGO, non-government or community organizations, and external experts. So what did the street design and implementation process include? One, it included identification of a street a street stretch or a road that could be undertaken for redesign. And it meant that we would have to define a study area, which we included would be approximately 100 meters from the road stretch itself, creating a base map. and then undertaking an existing situation analysis, which included all the surveys that we needed to include, including, for example, topographic and landscape surveys, survey of pedestrian facilities, public activity and street vending surveys, traffic surveys, perception surveys, and there are different ways in which this could be organized. This could be perception surveys, this could be done through workshops, design charrettes, or stakeholder interviews, land use surveys, pedestrian cycling and movement surveys, parking surveys, and accident data. Now, in each of these, we have actually specified, for example, when should the traffic survey be conducted, and what should the traffic survey actually include. This should be followed by an analysis, which includes, for example, a walking and cycling audit, universal accessibility audit, an understanding of parking management, road capacity and traffic management, and identifying areas that have public activities. So they could be nodes, they could be landmarks, and these could be special features. After this will lead to creating a concept plan, which would be presented to the which would be used to invite community feedback, as well as be put up for the review committee. And then this would be approved by, this would need to be approved by the review committee and the street design cell. This could then be tested on site so that you could understand and learn what was going on the ground. We have been doing this in multiple places already. And then afterwards, once you've tested it on site, made the changes to the drawings, this would have to be approved by the street design cell, which could then go for detailed design, construction drawings, and creating a tender for contractors. We also recommended a supervision. We obviously also recommended supervision and a broad maintenance program, as well as performance monitoring. One of the big things that we emphasized during implementation is creating a work zone management plan, which included, amongst others, creating a safe path for pedestrians while undertaking street works. Happy to talk more based on questions that we have.
Thank you so much, Sonal. That was really good information summarized. Over to you, Pranjali, and we'll take questions right at the end of the webinar. Pranjali, please share your screen.
So, Kashmira? Hello?
Hi, yes.
Yeah, so Parin will start now.
Okay.
Because that topic is kind of related to Sonal's topic. So, if Parin starts, and then I'll go to,
Hello. Is my screen visible?
Yes, it is.
So hi everyone, again, part of the HAD committee, we revised IRC 70, which was written way back in 1977, and the name of the document being Regulation and Control of Mixed Traffic in Urban Areas. The way I'm going to in the presentation, I'm going to touch upon three main things. One, why the document was revised in first place. Second, what was the previous table of contents and how we have revised from that. And thirdly, in each of the chapters that we have proposed or revised, what are the key contents in each of the chapter? That is what I'm going to speak in it. So first, beginning with the existing context, firstly, the way the document says regulation of mixed traffic in urban areas. As we know, in Indian context, the traffic composition is quite heterogeneous. So if we look into our own cities, we have walking, cycling, cycle rickshaws, bus, various kinds of transport. And also we see that a lot of cities which are between having a population of 1 to 5 million also have e-rickshaws. So with this kind of a traffic composition, the next question is who gets the space and how does one plan for it? So this document is very relevant in our context, especially for the cities between 1 to 5 million population, helping engineers and planners how to manage traffic and safety of all users. With the increase in private motorized vehicles, the key issues that we see is road safety, especially for cyclists and pedestrians, lack of access and comfort, again, for vulnerable road users, and air pollution from road transport. So the need for revision of this document was basically on these four aspects. First is that the earlier document was in a way car-centric, in the sense it prioritized the movement of fast-moving vehicles. So it did provide, it did have provisions for provision of footpaths, cycle tracks, but the narrative in which it was written, it saw slow-moving vehicles as hindrance and saw it as hindrance to the movement of fast-moving vehicles. So firstly, the narrative had to be changed, and as Sonal said, planning manual being the parent document, where the basic premise of the document is to promote sustainable transport. So this document also had to be rewritten from that perspective. Second, as we already we know that the National Urban Transport Policy has focused on sustainable transport. So also to begin with that, this document had to be revised on the principles of NUTP policy. Meanwhile, over the 40 years, we have seen that IRC has produced new documents, especially 103 on pedestrian guidelines, and has revised various other guidelines, especially on road markings, road signages, parking facilities, which had to be given. So these documents had to be given those references and had to be updated on the basis of that. And the very most important thing, the guidelines that have been suggested in the previous document, especially with respect to footpath cycle tracks, they are standalone guidelines and they don't necessarily are in with respect to the typologies of the road. So what we have done in planning manual as well as in IRC 70, we have contextualized the guidelines based on the typologies of the road. So the comparison of the table of contents. So if you see on the left hand side is the previous content. So the primarily the document suggested two guidelines. One is road engineering guidelines, that is the geometric design, and other is traffic management guidelines. So what we have done, we have followed the same thing, but we have further elaborated on various other things which I'll be speaking about. So if you see the right hand side table of content, which basically broadly speaks about the various things which are listed on introduction scope, we have included public transport pieces on IPT, very important, how does one manage commercial traffic in cities, on street parking management, which is a very vital part of this document, intersections, role of information communication technologies, awareness, also with respect to legislative measures, what are the legislative measures that have been written in the road safety bill, and how the and what are those pieces that I will go through in each of the chapters. So as we begin with chapter 1 and 2, basically it is on introduction and scope, and I already explained to you in the previous slides, which basically gives the whole background of the need to revise this document. And this is the mode priority, which Sonal has already spoken in the planning manual, which we are aligning all these documents together from the sustainable transport point of view. So basically giving prioritizing NMT and PT. In chapter 3, we give a basic just about the, you know, slow zone and fast zone and shared zone, and how does one need to segregate. Also in chapter 4, we have spoken about broad design guidelines, which are again following the design guidelines being suggested in planning manual with respect to various typologies of road, along with special conditions, urban expressways, NMT streets and greenways. These guidelines have been already been explained in the planning manual presentation. Same with the speeds. Now, this piece, which is very important piece in the document, which is chapter 5, which speaks about segregation of vehicles. So as we know, we have seen cities building segregated cycle tracks, also bus lanes, but there are cities which have also planned segregated lanes for two-wheelers, also for auto rickshaws. And there are cities like Paris, which have also gone ahead and done shared bus lanes where cyclists and bus lanes share the lane together. Now, the key question is how these guidelines are relevant in our context. So what we have done is we have spoken about each and every condition and how does it suit well in our conditions is something which we have elaborated in the document. So for instance, segregated motorized two-wheelers, we have not recommended them in our guidelines. We have, in fact, for those who, if you are interested, we had taken the reference of these guidelines from in-house publication by Walter Hook and Bert Fabian. So if you are interested, you can go and look into that. But primarily, what we have suggested is that if the volumes of two-wheelers and auto rickshaws are more than 50%, you need not provide a segregated lane. What would be helpful? One can provide such lanes on urban expressways where the speeds are 80 kilometers per hour. Also, we have given various guidelines on the dimensions of the cycle tracks. So as you can see, these have been there. So especially with lanes which have cycle rickshaws, we are suggesting 2.5 meters in one-way direction and 3.5 meters in two-way direction. Also, with respect to public transport bus lanes, we have said it requires a lot of enforcement, especially taking examples from Singapore, London, and Paris, which are in the document. However, we suggest that they should be median segregated bus lanes in the form of BRD. Also, we have piece on segregation for emergency vehicles. However, we say we are not recommending to have a segregated lane for them in emergency vehicles because they're going to be used for mixed, people are going to bound to use those. So we don't really recommend them. So all these guidelines have been given in the document. Then we have piece on traffic calming measures. As you can see, there are various traffic calming measures that we have listed here, and with whatever what is suitable have also been explained in the document. We have chapters 6 and 7, which speaks about public transport and intermediate public transport facilities. So in case of public transport, we have focused on providing it covers mainly 4 things: bus stops, bus bays, BRT, and multimodal integration. In each of these cases, for example, in bus stops, we have said what should be the location of the bus stops, how does one design the area around bus stops. In case of bus bays, we don't recommend bus bays. However, we have said in cases of urban expressways where the speeds are high, one can consider bus bays there. We have pieces on BRT, a very gist of it. Obviously, the further elaborate thing would be covered by Pranjali, multimodal integration. Also, we have piece on IPD, which says about sheltered spaces, alighting, boarding spaces to be planned for them. Chapter 8 speaks about commercial traffic. How does the city plan for to regulate commercial traffic in mixed use? So especially the earlier document was restricting commercial vehicles in the city center. So we have also given suggestions that how the heavy vehicles could be restricted, but then the further loading unloading happens by smaller vehicles. So those small pieces of traffic management for commercial vehicles have been elaborated there. Next piece is on cycle traffic. So here we suggest guidelines on the design of cycle tracks. So as you can see, we suggest buffer cycle tracks, trees for shading, median cycle tracks. Also, we have spoken about the surface lighting, facilities for parking for cycle. 10th chapter speaks about pedestrian traffic. In the earlier document, again, there was a mention of the pedestrian traffic, but over the as we've seen, we have given we have spoken about three zones in the design of footpath: residential, commercial, and high intensity commercial zone, and how the width changes that have been included here, also taking reference from IRC 103. Other details on crossings, on street parking management, we have given what should be the dimensions, what should be the priority in which one should set on street parking. Also, in on street parking, we have given a table in the document which gives basic dimensions of all the vehicles for their parking, and also additional key considerations that one need to take care of. Pieces on intersections, especially bicycle box, how does one need to, in case of larger intersections, the case of square roundabouts. We have also spoken about signal facing. Eventually, these chapters, chapter 13, we have spoken about regulation and management of traffic, which basically talks about not only management of traffic in the city with respect to, it covers mainly different conditions during temporary events, construction zones, how does one manage one-way streets, urban freight. Also, we have included piece on test on site, especially on tactical urbanism. Also, we've spoken about travel demand management in this chapter with respect to congestion pricing and parking districts and on-street parking management. We have pieces on road signs and markings, again giving reference to IRC documents on IRC 35 and 67 respectively. Legislative measures, which include basic safety gears for different modes of transport, pedestrians, motorcycles, what they need to consider, on speed of vehicles, what are the key pieces in motor vehicle bill. So that have been further elaborated on. Role of information and communication technologies in terms of real-time data, GPS, availability of real-time information on public transport to make commuters' life easy and promote public transport. And final piece on public awareness and education, especially communications, of how does one have capacity building programs with not only the with the bureaucrats or with engineers, but also with the citizens, with schools, with various other institutions in promoting sustainable transport, to getting them to know what are the benefits of it, and also on safe road driving. Yeah, that's it. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Parin, for highlighting our work in the revision of IRC 70. Over to you, Pranjali, on our IRC BRT guidelines.
Yeah. Hi. Can you see my screen?
Pranjali, we can. Can you put it on slideshow?
Yeah. Yes. Okay. Yeah. So first, I would like to share the context and some background and like what happened actually before they finalized these BRT guidelines. So in IRC, actually, when it the discussion started, there were kind of two groups, and one group was of the opinion that because BRT in many Indian cities are not a success story, IRC should not get associated with the BRT, and we have to be very careful, and we should think whether we should publish these guidelines or not. Whereas on the other hand, other side, the other group was of the opinion that because many cities are not able to do a good BRT, that's the reason IRC needs to have these type of guidelines, so that cities should learn from the guidelines. And finally, of course, the second group won, and then they decided to go ahead with these guidelines, and the draft printed version is out, and hopefully in next 2-3 months we'll get the final print of this document. Okay. So I'll start with the what are the contents of this document. So we start with the introduction of the BRT and giving the what is BRT, kind of a technical definition of the BRT, But in simple language, we say that it's a rapid mode of transportation that combines the quality of rail transit and the flexibility of buses, which we always use in our advocacy work. It also mentions the basics of BRT because, of course, it has got a background of a BRT standard and a scorecard. Whereas we say that dedicated ROW, busway alignment, smart fare collection, intersection treatment, and level boarding are the basics of the BRT. So it has to have a dedicated bus lane. The alignment should be in the middle of the street in the median. There has to be level boarding. Intersection treatment should be there so that the bus movement gets prioritized. And of course, the system should have efficiency in terms of throughput, improvement of the street. The ridership should be improved after the BRT. It should be affordable to the city. And of course, it should be quickly implemented so that and expanded rapidly. The BRT should target to have more shift from private motorized vehicle to BRT, and it should result in the emission reductions. So then let's go to the basic question when it comes to the BRT. In many cities, the cities construct bus lane and then they call it a BRT. So that we have tackled this issue in our document saying that there are four types of prioritizing bus movement. So first comes as a curbside bus lane. So we are saying that there can be bus lane, but it's not a BRT. Still, in some circumstances, city can go ahead with the bus lane, but it's not a BRT. A city can have bus ways where the segregated lane will be in the middle of the street, but all the buses, ST buses, school buses, all the buses will go use the corridor. For example, Delhi and Pune earlier corridors were like this, like so they were bus ways essentially. And then we come to the closed BRT and the hybrid BRT, where the closed BRT means the buses in the BRT lane will only use the BRT lane and they will not go outside the corridor, and there will be several terminals and transfer stations from where passengers will make a transfer and take feeder buses. And the fourth and the second type of a BRT is a hybrid bus operations, which is becoming very popular these days, where we are saying that the corridor may end at whatever appropriate location, but the buses can go outside the corridor if there is high demand outside the corridor, and the same bus can use the corridor. But of course, here again, we are saying that because this flexibility is there, the other buses cannot enter the corridor. So to qualify it as a BRT, there will be special buses which will only ply on this corridor, but they can go outside the corridor. For example, Pimpri-Chinchwad is doing this, and I think Janmarg is now also started to think about it. We also give comparison of all these four types of from curbside bus lane, busways, closed BRT system to hybrid BRT system on various parameters. And of course, you can see that closed BRT and hybrid BRT give all the features, and that's why they qualify as a BRT and not the curbside bus lanes or busways. We also highlight important fact behind the BRT, that why cities should think about BRT very seriously, because it can efficiently it can improve the efficiency of the street from 3,600 PPHPD, passengers peak hour per direction, to 12,000 with decent kind of a dedicated BRT service. And the next chapter talks about planning for BRT. Of course, it's a very technical matter, and because IRC is engineering sort of a guidelines, we are only mentioning that there has to be so much in-depth study which has to be carried out before implementing BRT. And there will be surveys, modeling process, network representation, and all this detailed work before any city wants to take decision and implement on BRT. We also highlight the fact that why cities should choose a BRT system over other systems, because there can be multiple options like metros, LRTs, monorails, and several types of BRTs. And several types of BRTs give different PPHPDs. So a basic BRT, like for example, which we have in Pune or even Janmarg, is like BRT with regular buses. Some cities like Hubli Dharwad have BRT with articulated buses, which will enhance again and improve the ridership to further extent. In India, we don't have BRT with bi-articulated buses. And Indore has BRT with passing lanes. So Indore BRT has a great potential to reach up to and compete with Pagota. And there can be monorails, LRTs, and metro rails. But of course, this graph gives the decent picture of like which system can carry how many passengers. And the same thing like comparison of different types of a system based on dedicated ROW, level boarding, electronic fare payment, real-time passenger information system, and high quality. So all these five features are available in all the four types like BRT, metro rail, LRTs, and monorails. But there are several features like quick and easy access to stations, which only BRT can provide, and maybe LRT if it's a surface LRT. But metro and monos, you have to climb up or down to access those systems. And again, in terms of capacities, because BRT gives a lot of flexibility, there is scope for increasing the PPHPD very efficiently. And of course, metro also gives very high PPHPD. But LRTs and monorails have limitations to improve the PPHPD on the same track. And as long as multiple services per corridor are considered, BRT can give you multiple services. And with hybrid BRT, there can be literally like you can reach to many destinations in the city. But in all the rail-based system, you have to have another track to provide different, like multiple services. Again, express services, the same thing you, BRT can give you on the same line. And affordability, yes, because BRT is a cheaper option for the city itself. So the fare becomes affordable for the customers. And yeah, in the same cost, if the city has 1,000 crore rupees, they can just do 2.5 kilometer of underground metro. And recently we got to know from Mumbai and Pune that they can only do 1 kilometer of underground metro. So we have to revise this map. And but whereas in same 1,000 crore, you can just do 65 kilometers of BRT, which is like, you know, covering entire, like all the major roads in the cities, like maybe Nashik and Ranchi, our cities of population 20 lakhs or so. In the next chapter, we talk about system design, where first thing is station alignment. Of course, when we work with various cities, we always promote median stations because it has got more efficiency. It becomes easy for the driver to dock at the station, and you can have less cost per station. But yes, because it's a technical thing, we are also saying that there can be median lane with the stations on the both side. That is curbside station. So we are giving details of both the types. And of course, with some pictures and images to explain what we are saying. Median station and curbside stations. We also talk about station saturation and give very complex formula and detailing of how to calculate this poor station design. But So poor station design can lead to either bus bunching and or maybe overcrowding at the station. Both the images are of Indonesia's example. Whereas if you do proper calculations like this Bogota and Guangzhou, you can have a proper like sub stops and properly calculated number of passengers in each station, you can have a very good efficient system. The next chapter talks about the station design in detail. Whereas, of course, when we are saying it should be comfortable and aesthetically nice, we also give technical details like there has to be have a platform extension of 200 mm so that the bus doesn't dash with the bus station. 200 mm is sufficient ledge which should be there on at the entry exit of the from the bus station. The ceiling should be extended so that the station remains weather protected, and the platform and the bus floor height should be at the same level. To have more efficiency in docking, cities can go ahead with castle curbs, where the castle curbs guides the bus so that the bus docking is more efficient, and the bus can dock really close as like, you know, less than 5 centimeters the station. And of course, closed stations should have station doors which should be automated, and when they should open only when the bus arrives. This is a picture from Indore BRT. We also give a station layout in detail, like what are the elements it should have. It should have ramp, it should have a special fare collection area, and a proper circulation and waiting space. We also give modular concept for these designs so that the same station can be used for various types of BRT buses. like in modular design, you can use the same station for regular 12 meter long bus or 18 meter long articulated, or maybe in future bi-articulated bus too. We also mentioned a couple of architecture features, like there has to be seating arrangement, etc., like so that passengers can be comfortable at the station. We also give detailed designs of terminal designs and some idea about there can be like different layouts of having a nice terminal. For example, here it's showing, this terminal shows that on the one side, on the left side, you can see BRT bus can dock there, and on the right side, the non-BRT bus comes. So the passengers don't need to go from one area to another or to cross the road. They are in the same enclosed area. So we also give layouts of such terminal designs. Then the next chapter, we talk about corridor design, where we give street sections of various ROWs and give like how we can accommodate BRT in it with the station. We also talk about single lane versus passing lanes, and the image below shows that how to say passing lanes on the both sides can be accommodated in minimum space. With some examples like Indore, this is an Indore's I-bus where there is provision of overtaking lane at the station. So in future, they can start express services and a bus can skip the stop if it is not in its list. We also talk about intersection design and why it is important, because the delays for the buses happen at the intersection. So the intersection, especially the right turn for the private vehicles, if that is resolved, the overall signal phasing can be much more efficient and the buses don't need to stop for longer time at the junction. So we give these two, three options of how a right turn for the mixed vehicle can be banned at particular intersection. Or there can be ways like two-way signal phasing. This is a picture from Ahmedabad, the Janmark BRT, where they have two-way signal phasing, which gives more throughput for at the, this junction. Some cities implement something like this, which is Pimpri-Chinchwad, where there is an island for the other vehicles, but for the bus, there is a cut through so that the bus can go directly without taking the island and spend some time in doing that. The access, station access becomes very critical, because in many cities, in whether it is Delhi or Pune, the station access was criticized a lot, and pedestrian safety and passenger safety was always debated. So we give various options of providing station accesses. So here we are showing that, of course, the station should be located minimum 45 meters from the... Hello.
Yeah, Pranjali.
Are you able to see the screen? Hello.
Yeah, can you just put it on slideshow mode?
Yeah, but
which slide were you on?
No, because Harsh just checked his account and he told me that it's showing some old slide only and it's not. Wait a sec.
Yeah.
Can you see station access from intersection slide?
Yes, I can, but it's...
Okay.
Yeah, click on that.
I don't know why it's doing this. Just a second. Is this fine now?
It's still the same, but it's fine. Please continue, Pranjali.
Okay. Yeah. So so station access becomes very critical. So here we are saying that, of course, bus station has to be located 45 meters away from the junction, and so that buses can wait at the junction. At least 2-3 buses can wait at the junction without disturbing the buses which want to take the passengers. Then it becomes very critical to provide access from the intersection to the station, and we are showing the direct access from the intersection to station from the central pedestrian access, dedicated pedestrian access. And we are also showing another access directly at the station. And of course, in this case, we have to have signal coordination and synchronization so that vehicles don't feel like, you know, we have to stop, because like politically it becomes very tough to have to duplicate, I mean, have two different pedestrian accesses. And we also talk about some other ways so that the BRT gets priority at the junction. For example, in Pimpri-Chinchwad and also in Ahmedabad, they wanted to construct flyover. Of course, the fact is they should not build flyover if they want to go ahead with the BRT, but politically they wanted to do it. And if, even if the city wants to do it, there has to have, like they can provide direct BRT lane below the flyover so that the buses get priority and bus movement doesn't get disturbed because of the flyover. In the next chapter, we also talk about universal access, where, of course, we are saying footpaths as per IRC 103-2012, because at that time, this another guidelines on the pedestrian, I mean, the street, it's, that was not published. So we are saying footpaths should be as per the IRC 103. The universal accessibility and especially level boarding should be taken care of when they are going for the BRT. And at grade station access gives that you know, convenience for people with special needs. The access ramp provides a ramp for like wheelchairs to access the BRT station very easily. In, again, Delhi. And we also talk about vehicle design, where we are saying UBS2 compliant buses. Of course, UBS2 is a big book, and it also gives some kind of flexibility to choose from different types, but still, they are of high quality and high standard, so that we are saying that you just follow UBS2 compliant UBS2 specifications, which also talks about the reserve space for wheelchair users in the buses, so that when you directly enter from the BRT station to bus, there is a dedicated space for the wheelchairs. We also talk about safety of passengers through different ways. And of course, it's not just about building, creating a BRT. There has to have a nice NMT network to support the BRT and the last mile connectivity. So we very quickly also talk about it. And the other aspects like enforcement should be there. In terms of BRT operations, because these are IRC standards, which are mostly referred by the engineers, we also talk a little bit about operations, because they should also know about the operational side of this BRT, because it's not just creating infrastructure, but BRT is a system. So we talk about various fare collection systems, where we discuss different types, like from onboard fare collection to completely offboard fare collection with smart card, and we give which is the, and a city can choose from this, like whether they want to go ahead with the high cost type or the more flexible system, etc. So we give these guidelines to them. City can also implement smart card. We also talk a little bit about how the access control for the fare collection happens through turnstiles and flap gates, and how they can also be designed so that there is access for the separate access for the wheelchair. Then passenger information system, of course, BRT, this is also comes under basics of the BRT, where the BRT should have proper passenger information system on the bus station as well as on the buses. And operations should be controlled in the control center. We also talk about intermodal integration, because many cities have auto rickshaws and some cities are going ahead with the metro. So we also talk a little bit about multimodal integration. Of course, we don't give detailed designs of it, but we address that the city should look towards multimodal integration at various locations. We also give depot layout designs as you know, just as a reference. There can be multiple ways to design depots, but we give some examples from Surat and typical depot layout in which they can, and what are the different features and different. In the couple of last chapters, we also talk about evaluating the system, because it's not just about the creating system, but the city should also monitor its performance and evaluate it time to time. So we talk about design evaluation and design features and performance evaluation, like operational evaluation and passenger satisfaction. And we also give a couple of like checklist definition and references. So the checklist also checklist talks about all the elements of the BRT any city should check before they want to inaugurate the BRT. So the checklist is very important, and it gives them like what all the pending work and what all the different elements any good BRT system should have. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Pranjali. Thank you so much, all of y'all, and hope y'all like this webinar.